When you're doing a roof installation on an existing structure and you remove the old roof, sometimes you're going to have to repair or replace some of that plywood decking that exists because it's either not level, it's out of plane, maybe there's some moisture issues, especially if there's a leak. So in today's video, we're going to talk about exactly how to inspect, remove, repair, and level a plywood deck for an existing building. What's up, guys? Welcome to the Metal Roofing Channel. I'm Thad Barnett. Subscribe if you're new. We release metal roofing and metal construction content every Monday and Wednesday. Well, today we're talking about plywood decking on residential applications, how to inspect it, how to remove it, how to level it out, and how to make sure that when you repair it, you have the best decking possible to put your new roof over top. So today we have Matt Lane from Metal Construction Solutions and Installations. He's a truly great craftsman. He knows what he's talking about with roofing, and especially standing seam metal roofs. So let's go over to him and discuss plywood decking and how to repair and how to replace it.
How you doing today? I'm Matt Lane with Metal Construction Solutions and Installations. Today we're working on a metal roof replacement on Adam Mazzella's house. Today we're going to be talking about plywood, plywood deck replacements, reasons we might have to replace the plywood. You know, and just some general things to look for. On Adam's house, or on any house we come across, you know, we tear the shingles off, we're getting down to the plywood deck. You know, the house may be 10, 15 years old, maybe 30 or 40 years old. So when it comes down to inspecting the deck, we really don't know what we're gonna come across, which is one reason it's always a good idea to tear the shingles off. You know, if you throw that metal roof over your shingles, you run screws in it, you really don't know what you have. You're dealing with an expensive product. You know, one that could service you for years to come as long as you take the proper precautions. So we want to tear the shingles off, we want to do a plywood inspection, and we can come across anything from mold or mildew, water damage in the valleys, just a complete rot in some areas. Some other things you can come across is just loose nails, loose fastening. Over the years the house has moved, you know, maybe it wasn't secured properly enough. So these are things we all want to look at when we come down to replacing our plywood. Some of the things we came across on Adam's house, we did come across loose nails. The plywood in some areas was just butted too tight together. When the plywood needed to expand, the corners, you know, they were running into each other, the fasteners were loosening up. So some areas of the house, we had to make sure gapping was right, and we had to refasten sections of plywood. Other areas on Adam's house, we had complete rot in some areas. There was water damage that had gotten through the shingles, had gotten through the underlayment, and the plywood was just punky. We couldn't put a screw in it anymore, and we put our new roof on. And that's mainly our reason why we need to inspect our plywood. When we go to put this roof on, we've got engineering in our metal roofing system, we've got engineering in our clips, and we've got engineering in our fasteners. So we're dealing with pullouts, we're dealing with, you know, plywood thicknesses. So when we go to put that fastener in, if we don't have an adequate substrate to put that in, we can do all the engineering in the world for the metal roofing system, but if the plywood's bad, it won't help anything. And that's another reason too, we inspect our plywood. So we got our nails, if our roof sheathing is loose, if it's not installed properly, you know, if just age has taken its toll, you can put the roof system on, and with a bad enough storm, you can actually lose the plywood with the roof system. This has happened before as well. On Adam's house, we had to replace several sheets of plywood. We found areas that were damaged. When it comes down to replacing the plywood now, it can get a little tricky. It's not an easy job, you know, it's you know, sweat and labor intensive, same with tearing off the shingles. You know, you gotta get in there, sometimes you've gotta get in there with hammers, sometimes you've gotta get in there with pitchforks, the shingle removers, you know, two, three guys, you know, some sheets come up real easy. Others, you know, they just don't want to budge. So obviously, you know, you're getting in there with your hammer. Safety is a big precaution, you know, gloves, safety glasses. You just want to make sure you're safe. You want to make sure you're in a position where you're not going to be at risk to getting injured either. But, you know, prying the plywood off, you know, making sure you get all the nails out, replacing the plywood with a new sheet. Obviously, you want to make sure when you put that new sheet in, you're not real tight. You have a small gap. Typically, an eighth inch is pretty good for any plywood that needs to expand or move. You know, you don't want to cram that plywood together and have issues in the future because we didn't leave that small gap. When it comes down to making sure you've got a good and plain roof, the first thing you need to do, I would think, you know, we always do is just to visually inspect it. You know, you can walk around the house, you can look at the ridges, you can look up the roof line. Your eyeball is going to tell you a lot. And if you can't see it in your eye, you know, probably not going to show on the roof, but you really need to make sure you're looking for it because it will affect the finished product of the panel. We ended up with some areas on Adam's house where there were really large dips in the roof, and Adam had decided at this point, you know, he didn't want to put this metal roof on and deal with those. So what we tore off, you'll see on the back of the house, we tore off a section of plywood. We ran string lines across the roof at the plywood height, and then we measured that down, and we actually sistered 2x on there because there was a lot to pull up in order to flatten that roof off. And thankfully in that area, we did have to deal with plywood rot too. So we had to take the sheets off anyhow. And in that way, you know, with pulling the string lines, putting the 2x on the sides to bring everything up to height, we're able to level that plywood out, you know, and come up with a nice finished product. That way, when that metal roof panel goes on, you know, we really limit the risk of having oil canting or any other, you know, issues with clips being funny or anything of the like. Let's talk about a special case in Adam's roof. You know, we're kind of looking at, you know, issues with shimming small areas. When we tore off Adam's Valley, and I don't know if we had it on video or not, but we ran into, when the roofers did the job, it almost looked like they had done a re-roof or an addition. They had several small pieces of plywood running up the valley, and the plywood would come into a joist, and then it would stop before it would make the other joist. So over time, there was nothing to support that. So over time, the plywood had sagged and collapsed, and the valley was starting to go in a little bit. So what we had to do is we had to peel that plywood off. We had to sister a 2x4 on that joist because we want to support that. We don't want that hanging in there. We didn't have to mess with the main joist systems or anything, but we'd run 2x between the plywood abutments and then along the end of the plywood to give that some support and refasten that down. So when we were done, we had a nice, clean, straight valley. When it comes down to actually putting the right type of plywood on your roof, say you're replacing all your plywood or you're replacing a section, you know, I would personally refer to your local building codes. You're gonna need to know what their minimums are, what type of plywood they like. You're gonna have a nail pattern you're gonna wanna stick with. Typically, you have a 6-inch nailing perimeter with a 12-inch field, but like I said, every location, every building location is different. You're dealing with winds, you're dealing with different weather and environmental factors. So check with your local building codes. Make sure the plywood that you're putting on is something that they, you know, would recommend, and the nailing patterns you use and the fastening patterns are gonna meet their code as well. When it comes down to you're getting ready to do a job, you've got a tear off coming, you know, you've given a quote to the homeowner, a lot of times it would be a good idea, you know, to include that in your cost. Have a discussion with the homeowner and say, hey, oftentimes we tear off, you know, we're gonna run into situations we're gonna have to, you know, replace plywood decking. It's a good idea to have, you know, something in your quote, you know, say, you know, it's gonna be so many dollars per sheet of plywood decking to replace. That way, when you get to it, you know, and you find out, hey, I've got 4 sheets of plywood to replace, you know, it's not a big surprise to the homeowner, and there's this added cost that you're gonna have to deal with. It's already discussed ahead of time and things have already been worked out. On this project, we're not dealing with a commercial installation, but when it comes down to commercial installations, you're dealing with weather-tight warranties, and that's a big issue, because when you're dealing with your weather-tight warranties with your manufacturer, you need to make sure you're dealing with the engineering they're dealing with, you're dealing with the details that they're dealing with. You know, you need to meet all their requirements for that particular panel in order to meet those weather-tight warranty specifications. So Sheffield Metals, for an example, is going to have a specific plywood minimum that they've tested for screw pullout, for the UL 90 ratings, for the ASTM ratings, you know, that you're going to have to meet. When you install your clips, you're going to have to put your clips at certain locations, at certain distances, in order to meet that engineering that they've gone through a lot of work to attain. So you really want to make sure you're in contact with your representative, in contact with your metal supplier, to make sure that your plywood, your clip spacings, your details, you know, all meet their weather-tight warranty requirements for your project. You don't want to get a roof on, have an inspector come out, and all of a sudden have all sorts of issues because you didn't do the things that they're going to require you to do. That would just be a really bad day for everyone.
Thanks, Matt, for taking us through how to inspect, repair, and replace and level plywood decking. Make sure you subscribe here to the Metal Roofing Channel for more videos like this. Comment down below for any questions that you have. And as always, I'm Thad Barnett, and we'll catch you next time.